Jesus at the center of it all.
How many of you over the weekend had nerve-wracking, heart-breaking moments? Don't you agree that Zhong Wei tried very hard? Don't you agree that he did his best? But sometimes your best may not be enough, isn't it? Sometimes our best may not be enough for the occasion. I want you to just have that thought in mind for a while. Keep that thought that our best is not enough. Our best may not be enough. Amen? Can you just think about that for, just keep that in mind, and then we'll go on. But this morning we want to start on a completely new book. We're looking at the book of Romans for the next couple of weeks. Before our anniversary, and sometimes Romans can be a very difficult book for some people. But I want to tell you that the Lord has His own ways of making the Bible alive for all of us. And I trust that even as we go through this book of Romans, you will fall in love with the Word of God, knowing that He has good plans for us, knowing that all the time His heart is for you and for me, that He will work all things out for our good. Amen? Hallelujah. And I want you to have that openness of heart to know that, yes, there's going to be a lot of legal arguments. Yes, there's going to be some difficult passages. But, you know, at the back of it all, God has good plans for us. Amen? And He will work out all things for our good. What a wonderful testimony our sister Peggy shared. When the doctors gave all the negative things, but God worked it all out for good, isn't it? Amen? For Peggy, King Yip, for the daughter and the whole family. And because of that, we all can rejoice together. Amen? Hallelujah. Incidentally, that same verse, God will work it out all for our good, is in the book of Romans. The book of Romans is full of such promises, and it's going to be an exciting time. Well, the book of Romans talks to us a lot about different things about God. It talks about the relationship between God and man, and talks about how sin has cut that relationship, and yet God came in and brought salvation for all of us, and through His Son Christ Jesus, and the work of the Holy Spirit in creating us and regenerating us into new creation. But at the bottom of it all, the foundation of it all is this thing, the righteousness of God. Everybody say, the righteousness of God. What is the righteousness of God? What is righteousness? It's a big word, isn't it? It's a big word. And sometimes we say it without knowing what it means. Sometimes we say, such a righteous person, without understanding what it means. Actually, the word righteousness means to be in right relationship with God. To be in right relationship with God. Now, we all know how important it is to be in right relationship, isn't it? For some of us here who are working in a company, you know how important it is to be in right relationship with your employer, with your boss, isn't it? For some of us in business here, we know how important it is to be in right relationship with our customers, with our suppliers, and so on. Relationship is always the key, isn't it, they say. You got no relationship, nothing gets done for you. Nothing is done. But because there's a relationship, then something good can come of it. For those of us who are students, you know how important it is to be in right relationship with your teachers, with your parents, isn't it? You disobey your parents, then no pocket money for that week. Very susah, eh? So, right relationship is important. And righteousness talks about to be in right relationship with God. How can we be in right relationship with God? How can we be good enough for God? Remember we say, our best may not be enough. How can we be good enough for God? Well, the Bible tells us this. In 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 21, Paul says this, for he made him, God made Jesus him, who knew no sin, to be sin for us, that we might become the righteousness of God in him. God, there's a divine exchange on the cross. And that's what we did this morning, to remember, Fanjin led us to remember what it meant for us to partake of the communion, to remember Jesus. How on the cross, he exchanged. There was this divine exchange. He became sin for us so that we might become the righteousness of God in him. Amen? Hallelujah. So righteousness. Some of you may say, Pastor, you know, we just went through the book of Mark. We just went through Gospels. I read the Gospels. But did Jesus really teach about righteousness? Did Jesus teach about righteousness? I want to tell you, yes. In fact, what Paul is saying in this whole book of Romans is to continue on where Jesus left off. Jesus said, there are many things I want to tell you now, but you will not understand, he told his disciples. So now Paul explains all that Jesus has done, all that Jesus has said in the gospel, in the book of Romans especially. So Paul continued in the book of Romans where Jesus left off. Where did Jesus leave off? Well, the most famous sermon of Jesus is the Sermon on the Mount. And then in the Beatitudes, I think the fourth one you read, blessed are those who hunger and thirst for what? Righteousness. Everybody say, blessed are those who hunger and thirst for righteousness, for they shall be filled. Amen. So Jesus, right at the beginning of his sermon, he says that there are some of you here who needs to thirst and hunger for righteousness. But what is this righteousness? What is this right relationship with God? How does it come about? He didn't tell us yet. But he continues on to say in verse 20 in the same chapter, he said, for I say to you, he's talking to the Jews there at the time, unless your righteousness exceeds the righteousness of the scribes and Pharisees, you will by no means enter the kingdom of heaven. Ah, wow, that is something startling for the Jews at that time. They were there, they know that the scribes and Pharisees were righteous within the inverted commas. They obey the laws of the Ten Commandments of the Torah to such fine detail. Yet Jesus said, hey, that's not the qualifying mark. That's not good enough. The righteousness of the scribes and Pharisees are not good enough to enter the kingdom of heaven. You need to exceed that. We were watching the pole vault, you know, how these fellows run with a tall, long pole, and then they vault themselves over the pole, and how so many of them at that certain height, I think 5.95 meters or something, so many of them could not get through, you know. It was just not good enough. And it's just like that. The standards of the scribes and Pharisees are already so high. But Jesus said, if you want to enter the kingdom of heaven, you need to go that much higher than that. Amen? You understand that? Okay? So the righteousness of the Pharisees are not good enough. What is good enough? Well, before Jesus came to this verse, Jesus talked about the different ways that the righteousness of the Pharisees were expressed. He says that if you get angry with your brother, you know, then you are guilty of murder. If you look at a woman with lustful eyes, then you are guilty of lust. So Jesus is saying there's a righteousness more than just an outward righteousness. There's a righteousness that must come from within. And what is that righteousness? What is good enough to be in right relationship with God? Jesus said, therefore, you shall be perfect as your Father in heaven is perfect. The only righteousness that qualifies us is to be as perfect as God Himself. To be as good as God Himself. To be as righteous as God Himself. That's terrifying, isn't it? That's quite terrifying, isn't it? But thank God, He made a way out for us. he said, among other things, he continued on his sermon, and then he came to this part in which he tells us that, but seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness. He was talking about, before this, he was talking, do not worry about what you're going to eat, what you're going to wear. He said, look at the birds. They neither sow nor reap, but none of them go hungry. Look at the lilies of the field. You know, they are adorned in such beauty that is greater than all the glory of Solomon. You know, so see, she said, I'm not just talking about the spiritual things. I'm also talking about your day-to-day things. But just as the Gentiles, just as the pagans run after these things, because they want them, your Father in heaven knows that you need them. And therefore, seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness. Everybody say, seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these things shall be added to you. So, what is Jesus saying? Jesus is telling that all your righteousness, all our works righteousness, all our self-righteousness, you know, the Pharisees were praying in such a way that they want everybody to know that they're already holy people. They were fasting, and then they were make sure that everybody knows they're fasting because they look so sad, they look so, you know, their clothes are all not washed, they don't look, they were smelling, so everybody knows that, they were spending all their time fasting and praying, you know. There were all this right works righteousness, self-righteousness, but Jesus said, no, you don't seek after this. Things, but seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these things that the pagans run after will be added unto you. Amen. And that's where Jesus left off. Now, what did Paul say then? Paul says that Paul comes in Romans chapter 1 to tell us, he said, for I am not ashamed of the gospel of Christ, for it is the power of God to salvation for everyone who believes, for the Jew first and also for the Greek. That means for the Jews and also for the Gentiles. Why is Paul not ashamed of the gospel of Christ? Why is there power in the gospel of Christ for salvation for everyone who believes? He says, For in the gospel, the righteousness of God is revealed from faith to faith. As it is written, the just shall live by faith. So Paul is now continuing where Jesus left off. In the gospel, in the good news, is there is a righteousness of God that Jesus talked about that we must seek after. Amen? And that's right there in the gospel revealed for us. Then, if you have read your book of Romans, you'll know that the rest of Romans chapter 1 and chapter 2 talks about how man has been so corrupted, man has gone so far from God. And when it comes to Romans chapter 3, it says that there is none righteous. No, not one. There's no one, none who understands. There's no one who seeks after God. They've all turned aside. They all have together become unprofitable. There is none who does good. No, not one. There's no one good enough. Amen? There's none good enough. And that was an indictment. So Paul continues on, say, you need this righteousness of God because none of us are righteous enough. None of us are good enough. Then he goes on to verse 21 and 22 and say, but now the righteousness of God apart from the law is revealed, being witnessed by the law and the prophets, even the righteousness of God through faith in Jesus Christ to all and on all who believe. So now we get a little bit more understanding of what this righteousness of God is about. First of all, it is the righteousness of God that is revealed, which is apart from the law. You know what it means, apart from the law? Because he's talking to the Jews who thinks that if you follow all the laws of God, you'll be righteous enough. He said, no. The righteousness of God is not through just following the law. It's not by following the law. But it is revealed, it's witnessed by the law and by the prophets. The law points to this righteousness of God that is in the gospel. The law, with all its sacraments, with all its feasts and so on, points to what is required to become the righteousness of God. We know that today looking with hindsight, we know that in the Old Covenant, all the laws is about Jesus, isn't it? The Passover lamb is about Jesus. All the different feasts is all about Jesus. You know, every other law that they have about in almost everything else is all about Jesus. Even the Sabbath is all about Jesus being resting in the finished work of Jesus. You know, so the law bear witness. The prophets also. The prophets are all pointing forward to a time when a Messiah will come and save the people from their sins. And His name is Jesus. Amen. And that's what Paul is saying here, that there is this righteousness of God apart from the law, but yet witnessed by the law and the prophets. That the righteousness of God comes through faith in Jesus Christ to all and on all who believe. So we know something about the righteousness of God now. It is apart from the law, and it comes to through faith in who? In Jesus Christ to all who believe. Now we know that little bit as Paul begins unveiling. Then Paul goes on in chapter 4 to talk about how this is not, how this righteousness is not by works. Just as Abraham believed that righteousness came to Abraham, it's credited to Abraham's account. Romans chapter 4 says this, but to him who does not work, but believes on him who justifies the ungodly, his faith is accounted for righteousness. So Paul is saying it's not something you work for. Every month, at the end of the month, now I don't check anymore, but in the early years, I always call out to my bank and say, my salary creditor or not, because scared not enough money. So my salary creditor say, yeah, isn't it? Then can write my checks and pay things, you know? So, but that salary check, that they bank into my account every month, the company banks into my account at the end of every month, are wages for what I perform for the company. You understand what I'm trying to say? So, but Paul is saying here that it is not when this righteousness comes, you this gift of righteousness is a gift, and it is not because of what you have done, but it's because of where you put your faith in. Last week, Alex talked to us about belief, the relationship between belief and faith. You can believe in Jesus as your Lord and Savior. You can believe in Jesus as one who supplies everything for you. But you need to take that step of faith. Okay? So, how do we obtain this righteousness? This righteousness is credited into our account when we believe and trust in Jesus completely. Amen? And that's what Romans 4 tells us. That it is by accounted, our faith is accounted for righteousness. What's the effect of having this gift of righteousness? Romans 5:17 explains this. For if by one man's offense, by Adam's offense, death reigned through the one, much more those who receive the abundance of grace and of the gift of righteousness will reign in life through the one, Jesus Christ. What is the effect of having this gift of righteousness from God? What is this gift of right? What is righteousness again? Right relationship, okay? Right relationship with our Father. What is the effect when we have this gift of righteousness? Fan Jin talks to us about how we are clothed in the robe of righteousness. Paul, in this verse, talks about his gift of righteousness. When we have this gift of righteousness, we will reign in life. Hallelujah. What a glorious promise. You know, when you have that right relationship with your Father, as a small boy, you get a pocket money, he drives you to school, he gets everything done for you. But when you have this right relationship with your Father in heaven, you will reign in life through the one, Jesus Christ. Oh, what a glorious promise. We want to reign in life, isn't it? We don't want the problems of life to overwhelm us, isn't it? We don't want the storms of life to sink us, isn't it? We don't want all the pressures of life to just press against us. We want to be over them. We want to reign in life. And Paul says, the effect, the result of having this gift of righteousness through our faith in Jesus Christ is that we will reign in life. Hallelujah. Say, yeah, Pastor, that's okay. Yeah, I want to reign in life. But, you know, sometimes I have this tendency to always do wrong and so on. Then Paul reminds us in chapter 6, he says, having been set free from sin, the effect of this gift of righteousness and faith in Christ is to be set free from sin. We are now no longer become slaves of sin, but we become slaves of righteousness. We no longer be bound just every day. We cannot help it but to sin always. But no, Paul says no. Now you have become a slave to righteousness. Amen. And that's that relationship, a right relationship with God, can never be broken. And because you are a slave to righteousness, right living proceeds from your life. Amen. Right living, living right proceeds from your life. Amen. Hallelujah. Romans 8, it says, and if Christ is in you, the body is dead because of sin, your body is dead because of sin, but because Christ is in you, the spirit is life because of righteousness. How can a holy God be in us, live in us? It's because of the righteousness of God that we have become the righteousness of God, that the Holy Spirit is able to live in us. And when He lives in us, there is life. Life in all its abundance. Amen? Are you excited or not? You know, now, this is a gift of righteousness that Paul said, I'm not ashamed of. For in the gospel of Jesus Christ is revealed this gift. And this gift is to all who believe and trust in Him. Amen? Hallelujah. And in that gift is our ability to reign in life. In that gift is that we no longer become slaves of sin. We become slaves of righteousness. And in that gift is life, and life forevermore. Amen. But in the end, what is this right relationship? How is this right relationship crystallized? What do we become? Paul reminds us, he said, the Spirit Himself bears witness with our spirit that we are children of God, and if children, then heirs of God and joint heirs of with Christ. Hallelujah! God is good, isn't it? He didn't just save us, He made us sons and daughters of the living God, and not just sons and daughters, we become heirs of God. Everything God has becomes ours, everything Christ will inherit, we inherit Him with Him too. Hallelujah! What is the one thing that you want? It is all found in this right relationship as a son of the living God. Hallelujah. God is good, isn't He? And so, when you begin to read through your book of Romans the next couple of weeks, which I want to encourage all of us to do so, you know, I want to encourage all of us to continue to do so. As you read through the book of Romans, get excited about what God has for you. He wants to give us this gift of righteousness. And He has given that to us through His Son. Say, for He made Him who knew no sin to become sin for us, so that we might become the righteousness of God in Christ. Amen. Okay, so that's the introduction to the book of Romans. And I hope as you read through your book of Romans, you begin to underline and begin to see a theme flowing through the righteousness of God. Now, this morning we want to just look at the first 17 chapters of Romans chapter 1. Can we all read together this? Huh? Let's all read together. Huh? Why don't we all stand so that we exercise a bit? Huh? Okay, let's all stand. Okay, 1, 2, 3. Paul, a bondservant of Jesus Christ, called to be an apostle, separated to the gospel of God, which He promised before His prophets in the Holy Scriptures, concerning His Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord, was born of the seed of David, according to the flesh, and declared to be the Son of God, with power according to the Spirit of holiness, by the resurrection from the dead,
Through him we have received grace and apostleship for obedience to the faith among whom you are also a call of Jesus Christ. To all who are in Rome, beloved of God, called to be saints, grace to you and peace from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. Okay, please be seated. Read the rest a bit later. So Paul, a bond servant of Jesus Christ, called to be an apostle, separated to the gospel of God. Here we find the first seven chapters. Seven, you know, I like the number seven, you know why. There are seven aspects of the gospel. Seven aspects of the gospel in just first seven verses. And you know that they are long sentences, so I'm breaking them down so that we can see it together. Okay? First aspect of the gospel talks about who is the proclaimer. Who is the proclaimer of the gospel? He says it's Paul himself, Paul. Paul is the one identifying himself as a proclaimer of the gospel. First of all, he says, I have a calling. The gospel, I have a calling to come to proclaim the gospel. And I believe that God has a calling upon all of us here. We may not be Paul. We may not be called to be apostles to the Gentiles. But God has called all of us to share this good news. You know, it's like if you know where's the best char kway teow, you know, every time somebody goes to Penang, then they post about how they go to this stall or that stall and how that's the best, and people disagree with them, you know. But they want to share, say this is the best char kway teow. In the same way, if you know how good the gospel is, if you know how the gospel reveals the righteousness of God there, then we want to share, isn't it? We all have this calling upon our lives to share the gospel. An apostle is one who is sent out. Paul was sent out. So many of us may not be sent out to faraway countries, but we are all sent out to our homes, to our offices, to the marketplace, you know, and to different places. My wife is one of them. Huh? She can go to the market and buy clothes from a lady, and then we see the whole stall, you know, the lady, the husband, and the children all coming to know the Lord. You know, things like this. You know, we are all also apostles and sent. We are sent to where we are. Maybe not to a foreign country, but we are all called to be apostles of the good news. A bond servant. Now, this one needs a little bit of explanation, but very quickly. Paul is saying, I'm a bond servant. I don't need to be a servant. A bond servant means somebody who does it voluntarily. In the Old Testament times, it's something like this, that sometimes you become a slave. You become a slave because you owe somebody money. You cannot pay. So you say, okay, I will work for you to pay back my debt. At such a rate, I owe you so many thousand shekels. I work at one shekel a day and work for you 1,000 days, for example, or whatever. For the Jews also, in the 7 years, all slaves are again set free again, okay? So, but sometimes somebody owes a master so much money, he can work for the rest of his life, cannot be set free. But on the 7 years, he's set free, and then he said, this master is so good to me. And because I love this master and because he's so good to me, I don't want to be free. So I want to be a bond servant. So the master will take him to the doorpost, put his ear there and put a nail and hammer it a hole through to remind him that he has promised to serve the master as a slave, as a bond servant forever, for the rest of his life. And that's what Paul is saying there. I don't have to, but I'm serving Jesus Christ freely because I love him. And I trust that this is also true for all of us, that because we understand how much he loves us, because we know how much he has done for us, we want to serve him for the rest of our lives. He's set apart, separated, set apart to the gospel of God. So seven aspects of the gospel, the proclaiming the gospel, Paul claims that it's himself. I want to say to you all today that you too are called to be proclaimers. You too, all of us here too, are called to be messengers of the living gospel of Jesus Christ. Amen? The gospel of God, which he promised before through his prophets in the Holy Scriptures. Proclaimer, the next is provenance, okay? And that's a big word. I only learned it a few days ago. Yeah. Okay, so I was looking for a word to say, what is the origin of the gospel? So the provenance simply means origin, okay? The gospel of God, which he promised before through his prophets in the Holy Scriptures. You know, it was not something new. It was not something new. Because we know that in the Scriptures, it talks about how Jesus was slain, the Lamb of God was slain before the foundations of the world. God had this plan all along. It was planned, it was prophesied and prepared from the ages past. It began even in the Garden of Eden. In the Garden of Eden, when men sinned, there was this promise of a coming Savior who will crush the head of the serpent. Though the serpent may hurt his heel, but he will crush the head of the serpent. The seed of woman that will come, that will bring about this. So the gospel of God was promised through his prophets in the Holy Scriptures in the years past. Okay, so proclaimer, provenance, what else do we know about the gospel? Concerning his son, Jesus Christ, our Lord, who was born of the seed of David, according to the flesh, and declared to be the Son of God. You know, the center point of our church, the center point of our lives, the center point of God's plan for the whole world is none other than Jesus himself. The pivot upon everything where everything else hangs. You know, he's the one, everything else moves around that. He is the center of it all, Jesus Christ. And I trust that we will always keep it this way, that every time people come into the church, they know Jesus is here. Every time people come to church, they know Jesus is celebrated. Every time people come to celebrate a communion, they're reminded of Jesus. Every time people come in here and listen to a sermon, they know it's all about Jesus and what he has done for us. Amen? So what did Paul say here about Jesus? He says only Jesus, concerning his son Jesus Christ. The gospel is not about anything else. The gospel is not about how we can change the government or we can change society. No, the gospel is about Jesus Christ. And what do you know about Jesus Christ? He was born of the seed of David. He was a man. He was fully man because we know his human lineage is through David. And he's divine because it says here in Romans, it says, declared to be the Son of God. He's fully man and fully God. He's fully man so that he can identify with us, so he can die for us. He can die on our behalf, so he can die as us. But because he's divine, when he dies as a Son of God, then the efficacy of his death then is true for all humanity because he is divine. Amen. Then here we talk about Christ declared Jesus Christ our Lord. So he is the Messiah, the anointed one. We look at this in the book of Mark a few weeks ago. And our Lord. He's not just our Lord, he's also my master. I trust that he's your master too. Amen. So proclaimer, providence, pivot. What else do we have? Declared to be the Son of God with power according to the Spirit of holiness by the resurrection from the dead. The fourth thing we know about this fourth aspect of the gospel is this, that what is the proof? What is the proof that Jesus is the Son of God? And Paul puts it down very clearly, that it is not just somebody just, you know, died for a while and come out and then later to die again. No, the proof is Jesus rose from the dead once and for all. And when he rose from the dead, he conquered sin, he conquered death, and the devil himself. Today, we don't have to fight for victory anymore because Jesus won the victory for us. We fight from victory. Amen? We don't have to fight for victory. We fight from victory because He has won Him. He has conquered sin. He became sin for us so that we might become the righteousness of God. And we are now the slaves of righteousness. He has conquered death because He rose again from death. Death could not hold Him anymore. He rose again. He rose from the dead. And so because He rose, we have that hope that one day we will be raised together with Him and be seated with Him in the heavenly places. And the devil has no more authority on us. That's why in this church, we don't talk so much about the devil. We know he's trying to look around, but we know too, when we walk around, he's more afraid of us than we should be of him. Amen? Hallelujah. He's more afraid of us than we should be of him. Amen? We shouldn't be afraid of him at all, really. Because Jesus himself has conquered him. And through him, we have received grace and apostleship for obedience to the faith. What is the purpose? What is the purpose of this gospel? What is the purpose? First of all, the purpose of this gospel is to tell us that there is grace for us. What is grace? Grace is unmerited favor. Grace is unearned favor of God upon our lives that we don't have to earn. We don't work for it because of the gospel, because of what Jesus has done for us. We receive the favor of God. There's abundance of grace. And we know that whether it is like what Peggy testified of this, of the daughter and the pregnancy, there is grace abundance that defies human understanding. There is grace for us in our workplace. There is grace for us because we will be promoted 2 weeks ago or something like that. Jacqueline shared with us how among the 30, 50,000 employees, she was one of those young executives chosen to speak to the 120 senior, most senior people in this big ONG company. And then, and how, you know, that's favor, isn't it? You know, that's favor, just pure favor. And I want to believe for all of us here that all of us here in our own places, God has an abundance of favor stored for us. Amen. Apostleship. If grace is for us, then apostleship is for others. We are called, as I said earlier, we are called. The grace is also for us to be apostles. Some of you say, oh, I cannot, I don't know how to speak to people. I got nothing to share. I don't know the Bible well enough. All the excuses. But Paul reminds us there is grace for us for apostleship, to be sent to the marketplace, to our homes, to our families, to our workplace, to our school, to our colleges, to share this good news about Jesus Christ. And for obedience to the faith. What is obedience to the faith? Sometimes we read it and we think of a phrase like this, oh, then we immediately think obedience, we think of laws, right? When you say obedience, you think of rules and regulations. Obedience, you think of laws. Now, I want to remind you, I want to just explain that this is not what he's saying. Obedience to the faith. It begins with faith. Last week, I talked about faith. It's taking action when we trust, when we believe in Jesus. It's taking that action to live our lives in obedience to Him. Obedience to what He has done for us. Obedience, that means we want to be completely dependent on what He has done for us. Okay? Obedience means to be living in complete obedience to Christ. Not so much of rules and regulations, but more so, but simply so, that it is living in total obedience on Christ, in Christ alone, and no one else. To know that He will work all things out for our good. That despite the storms that we may be facing now, despite the difficulties some of us may be having now, despite the burdens that some of us may be carrying now, some concerns that are weighing down heavy in our heart, we know that Jesus is there for us. And there is an abundance of grace. And this gift of righteousness that He gives to us will enable us to reign in life. Amen. Purpose, and then unto all nations for His name, among whom you also are called of Jesus Christ. So who are the partakers? Who can share in this gospel? Who can share? Every one of us, whether Jew or Gentile, all of us, all we need is to believe and trust in what Jesus has done for us. Paul reminds us, right at the beginning of the book of Romans, he says that among all nations for his name, among whom you also are the call of Jesus Christ. As long as you believe, you can be a partaker of this gospel. You can be a partaker of this gift of righteousness that is found in this gospel, that is revealed in this gospel. To all who are in Rome, beloved of God, called to be saints, grace to you and peace from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. So we have proclaimer, providence, pivot, proof, purpose, particular, all big words, but just help me to think also. Okay. So you cannot remember those, never mind. Okay. But just help me a little bit. So what in the end, you know, all this, what does the gospel produce? What will the gospel produce in us? The gospel will produce in us, as we said earlier, we are now the beloved of God. We are now the beloved sons and daughters of God. Hallelujah, isn't it? Hallelujah. Called to be saints. Because here, saints means not somebody with a hello, you know. Saints just means we are set apart for God. He has set us apart. We are His special child. We are special children. We are special daughter. We are His special son. Set apart for Him and upon whom His favor will rest. Hallelujah. So that's the seven aspects of the gospel. Okay. I just want to quickly move on to the rest of it. Maybe you just read it together. Maybe I'll just read it, okay? First, I thank my God through Jesus Christ for all of you that your faith is spoken of throughout the whole world. So here Paul now, having put on as an introduction, laid down the seven aspects of the gospel. Now he said, now I'm addressing to you now, the Christians in Rome. So I want to thank my God for all of you. For your faith is spoken throughout the whole world. At that known world, there was a thriving church in Rome. And Paul says, I thank my God for you. And God is my witness, he said, at whom I serve with my spirit in the gospel of his Son. And that without ceasing, that he's continually always praying for them. Now, that somehow he may be able to find a way to go to them. Now, so Paul, up to this point when he wrote this letter to the Romans, he has not been there yet. So he's writing to the strangers, to strangers, so to speak. But they are brothers and sisters in Christ. So, but he's writing to them. So he says, you know, I thank my God for you. And every time, God is my witness, I care a lot for you. I'm praying for you daily. And I'm praying that one day I may find a way to come to you. So why does he want to go to them? He says, for I long to see you, that I may impart to you some spiritual gift so that you may be established. That is, that I may be encouraged together with you by the mutual faith of both you and me. So I want you to see the heart of Paul here. Paul said, I want to come here. I want to see you so that I may impart to you some spiritual gift so that you may be further established in the faith. Then he didn't end there. He says, so that I together with you may be encouraged by the mutual faith of both of us. That's the humility of Paul, isn't it? He's saying that, oh, I didn't come here just as a big brother. Oh, you do what? No, I want to come here. I want to give you what I have. And maybe at the same time, be encouraged by your faith. That's the heart of Paul. And I trust that we can all learn from Paul in that sense. Nor do I want you to be unaware, brethren, that I often planned to come to you, but was hindered until now, that I may have some fruit among you also, just as among other Gentiles. So Paul is saying that, you know, I want you to know, I really want to come to you. You know, I really plan to come to you, but somehow I've been blocked, I've been stopped. God has His timing. Some of us here are waiting for some answers to our prayers. Some of us here are just wondering, why God, why are you taking so long? Hey, see la, Paul. Paul wants to do something great. He wants to go to Rome to preach the gospel there. But somehow, God has His timing. And Paul knows. Paul's saying that somehow, I have I have been hindered, but I want to come that I may have some fruit among you, just I have among the rest of Gentiles. So don't be discouraged if you think God is slow in answering your prayers. Amen? His timing is there. He knows what is best. Amen? Hallelujah. I'm a debtor both to the Greeks and to barbarians. Barbarians means the others who are not so well educated, not so civilized as the Greeks, both to the wise and unwise. So Paul said, no, I want to speak to all. You know, this gospel is not just for the rich or for the learned and so on, but it's for the wise and for the unwise, for the barbarians and for the Greeks. And as much as in me, I'm ready to preach the gospel to you who are in Rome also. So Paul is saying that, I really want to preach. I really want to go there to preach. Okay? So then in verse 16, he goes and says, for I am not ashamed of the gospel of Christ, for it is the power, we looked at that earlier, of God to salvation for everyone who believes, for the Jew first and also for the Greek. For in it, the righteousness of God is revealed from faith to faith, as it is written, the just shall live by faith. So Paul said, I'm not ashamed. I'm not ashamed of the gospel. Why did Paul say, I'm not ashamed? Now, if you really look at the gospel, it talks about cross. It talks about somebody dying, you know. It gives the impression of somebody losing it all already. And yet, Paul says, I'm not ashamed. What is it referring to? He explains it in 1 Corinthians chapter 1. He says, for the message of the cross is foolishness to those who are perishing, but to us who are being saved, it is the power of God. He's saying here that, look, sometimes when we talk about Jesus dying for people say, oh yeah, die already, so what? You know? then all this, it looks so foolish. Yeah? And he goes on in verse 23, he says, but we preach Christ crucified, to the Jews a stumbling block. Because to the Jews, why is it a stumbling block? When somebody is crucified, he is hanged on a tree, so to speak. Anyone who is hanged on a tree is cursed, according to the scriptures, the Old Testament scriptures. Okay, if you are hanged on a tree, you are cursed. So to the Jews, how can a cursed person be my savior? How can a person cursed be a source of blessing to us? So that's why it's foolishness to a stumbling block to the Jews. And to the Greeks, foolishness. To the Greeks, you know, it doesn't make sense, lah. You know, he died, and then, you know, how can he help us? How can he? So Paul said, yeah, despite what people say about the gospel, I'm not ashamed of the gospel of Christ. For in it, there is the power of God. Amen? For the gospel of Christ, for it is the power of God to salvation for everyone who believes. So what is this gospel? What does it contain? First of all, there's a power of God that's working in the gospel. The power of God that is there in the gospel. When we believe what Jesus has done for us on the cross, that the power of God comes within us. What does it do to us? It regenerates us. It makes us a new creation. There is a new birth. We have died with Christ. When we believe in the gospel, we have died with Christ on the cross 2,000 years ago. And today, the life we live is the life of Christ in us. That's the power of God working in us. It is not about us trying to be more righteous, not about us doing our best to be as righteous as possible, to be as good as possible. But it is the power of God that's working in us, making us completely a new creation that will enable us to be good enough for His Holy Spirit to come and dwell in us. Amen? That's the power of God working in us. The power of God is there to bring health and healing. The power of God is there when His favor is upon our lives. The power of God is there when He works to change us, that people can see us as different and can see us as completely transformed by His power. What is the purpose for us? It is salvation. Salvation comes from a Greek word, soteria, as you know. Soteria is not being just saved from hell, just saved from the fires of hell, but soteria means wholeness, completeness, prosperity, health, and everything in it. The whole, Jesus said, I come to give you life. Life in all its abundance. And that's what he has come for. The purpose for us is so that we may receive the gift of righteousness, the abundance of grace and the gift of righteousness, so that we may reign in life. Amen? Hallelujah. The purpose for us. And what is the path to take? The only one path to take is to believe and trust in what he has done for us. Amen. That we only need to believe and trust in what Jesus has done for us. So for in it, the righteousness of God is revealed from faith to faith. We had talked about the righteousness of God earlier. So from faith to faith, it simply means the only way to know and understand God's righteousness for us is by faith and faith alone. You just need to simply trust and take the step of faith forward and receive it and embrace it to know and to give thanks to God. God, I thank you that because of Jesus, he became sin for me so that today I'm now the righteousness of God in Christ. You just need to embrace it by faith. And that is only by faith and faith alone. You can never fully understand it. It's beyond comprehension in a sense. All we need to do is to take that. And that's why the Greek considers foolishness. I mean, we always rationalize everything out. Now you ask me to take that step of faith. They forget that their whole life sometimes is also based on faith. We are sitting on a chair now. We believe that the chair will hold our weight. Maybe we saw other people holding other people's weight. But sometimes the chair can break and you can fall down. You know? The only way to understand, the only way to embrace and to fully see the righteousness of God for us, working in us, is by faith and faith alone. And Paul ends this passage by saying, the just shall live by faith. The just shall live by faith. What is the just? Okay, now again, a bit more technical. To justify. What to justify means to declare righteous. When God justifies us, when the Bible says God justifies us, it means God declares us righteous. Okay, so the just means those declared righteous. You and me are declared righteous, right? When we trust in Jesus and what he has done for us on the cross, we are declared righteous. And Paul's end this with a quotation in the Old Testament and say, the righteous, the just, so we can paraphrase it, the righteous shall live by faith. I'm so glad that last week we talked about belief and faith. And so today, the same message. The righteous. Who are the righteous? You and I, isn't it? Tell your neighbor, you are the righteous. You are righteous. And tell each other, then live by faith. Living by faith means trusting that Jesus will see us through completely. Okay? Trusting that Jesus will see us through completely. Now, having said that, it doesn't mean that we don't do anything. I want to believe and I trust that we all know that God has placed in us His life, His Holy Spirit to guide us and to lead us. I want you to know that God has placed in us the wisdom of Christ in us. God has placed in us many gifts that we never had before. Some of us have the gift of faith. Some of us give the prophecy. Some of us have the gift of knowledge. Some of us, you know, different gifts that the Lord has given to different ones of us. Some of us are given, you know, that it is the Lord. You were never a singer before, but now you can stand in church and sing. Why? Because the Lord has given you that gift. You never thought that you can be a teacher of the word, but the Lord has given you the gift. So now you teach, you know, and we are very excited every time as a pastor to see different ones coming up, because we know that the Lord has given those gifts to them, and now they're serving the body of the Lord together with all of us. Amen? So, the Lord has given us gifts. And so, it doesn't mean we don't do anything. Living by faith doesn't mean that we don't do anything natural. If the Lord has given us the gift of management, that we manage the company to the best of our ability, but at the same time knowing that success comes from the Lord. Amen? The Lord has given us the gift of health, so we still take care of our bodies, we still exercise, but knowing that our health comes from the Lord. Amen? Okay? And so, knowing, living by faith means trusting in Jesus completely. First of all, that He has saved us completely. There's nothing else we can do. Romans 4 says, it is not because of, it's not wages for your work, but it is credited account, your righteousness is credited to your account because of faith. Okay? So it's not because of work, not how much we work, but because He has given us this gift, now we can work to serve Him. We become a bond servant. Amen? And because of the gift, because He has given us health. And sometimes maybe certain things go wrong with our bodies. It is okay. Because we also want to believe that as the Lord opens the door for us, sometimes to see certain doctors or see certain people to help us out, that's okay. It doesn't negate your living by faith. Living by faith is something deep inside us. Faith is something deep inside us to know that God has our best interest in heart. Our Father, He has saved us. He has given us the gift of righteousness, not just to make us somebody outside His kingdom, or somebody just a citizen of His kingdom, but to be part of His family. Right? The Holy Spirit bears witness that we are sons. And if we are sons, then we are heirs, and heirs, co-heirs with Christ. Okay? So, that the right relationship, that relationship is so that we may be a son. And knowing that He cares for us, He will provide for us. But let us not just rest in that, but let's move forward as we exercise the gifts. As we move forward, we let us see even greater things that the Lord will work through us. So the righteous shall live by faith. Amen. You are the righteous. Live by faith, knowing that He has put in the gift of righteousness in you. Knowing that because of the gift of righteousness, you will reign in life. Amen? Knowing that because of this gift of righteousness, now you are sons and daughters of the Most High Father. And because of that, you're heirs and co-heirs with Christ Jesus. Everything that Jesus has belongs to you too. Amen? Let's all stand. This morning, perhaps some of us here has not received this gift of righteousness. And I want to give you an opportunity this morning to receive it. I want to give you an opportunity this morning to trust in Jesus as your Lord and Savior, and to know completely that even as you trust in Him, you will be a son of the living God. There are some of us here who may come for first time, second time, third time, 10 times maybe, but you never made this commitment. Can I encourage you this morning as we stand before our God to make that commitment? It's so easy. It's just simply saying, Jesus, I trust in You. I believe in You. And I place my faith in what You have done for me on the cross. Will you do that? I just sent there's some of us here who need to make this commitment. Nobody knows who you are. It doesn't matter. But the Father in heaven knows. So if you feel a prompting in your heart, in your spirit, you say, yeah, today is the day that I want to be counted among those who have this gift of righteousness. Will you pray together with me? Church, let's all pray together. Lord Jesus, thank You for dying on the cross for me, for becoming sin, so that I may become the righteousness of God in Christ. This morning, I acknowledge, I receive all that You've done for me on the cross. And today, and now, I proclaim and declare, I'm the righteousness of God in Christ Jesus. I declare, I'm a son of the living God. Thank You, Jesus, for this gift of righteousness. In Your name I pray. Amen, amen, amen. Hallelujah. Now just spend a few moments for all the rest of us. Maybe now is the time for us just to reflect on what the Lord is speaking to us. Some of us may have taken this gift of righteousness a little bit lightly because we don't understand. But this morning, I trust that you understand what Jesus has done for you on the cross, that He has given you this gift of righteousness. Some of us are struggling in our work. Some of us are struggling in our business. There are problems. But the promise is that when you receive this gift of righteousness, you will reign in life. Everybody declare, I will reign in life because of this gift of righteousness. So will you just spend a few moments just telling the Lord what you are struggling with and saying and repeating to Him and proclaiming to Him, say, Lord, I want to reign in life because I have this gift of righteousness. Can you just spend a few moments in that? Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Some of us are struggling with some physical ailments. The Lord wants you healed. The Lord wants you to reign in life and not to be in any way hindered by that ailment. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you. Lord, we thank you, Lord, for Jesus. We thank you, Lord, that we proclaim Him and Him crucified. Hallelujah. That while it may be foolishness and a stumbling block to others, yet, Lord, we know it's the power of God for us unto salvation for those who believe in this. We thank you and praise you. And we thank you, Lord, that for this gift of righteousness that you have given to us that enable us to reign in life. Thank you, Jesus. As we look forward to the week ahead, we know we will reign in the week ahead. In Jesus' name, amen. Hallelujah.